Recording in progress.
Tihe Moriora, en amana en areo e ro rangatirima. Tena koto katoa. You're all very welcome. For those of you who don't know, my name is Brendan O'Connell. I'm the Chief Executive of Agritech New Zealand, and in partnership with the Oz Agritech Association, with the ASX, with MB, and with the University of Waikato, we're very glad to have you in the room here and very glad to have you online with us today. And you, everything you say and do in this room will be recorded and shared widely. So please give generously in terms of your thoughts and comments. I know our panelists are set to do so. I feel like I've got sort of, whenever I stand in front of a pulpit, I have the recovering Catholic in me coming back, and I feel like I've got the stage and can preach. So I would just like to recognize that we are gathered here today for the beautiful joining of two vital things, which is both investment and innovation, and we'll be running a game of two halves. We have two panels for you today. And we have some speaker coming in from Australia as well to speak with us halfway through. I talk about the marriage between sort of investment and innovation. You know, when we look at growing our food, we obviously concentrate on water and light. And there's no doubt when we look at innovating around our food systems, we need to look at capital and the right sort of attention and connection. So those are some of the topics that we'll be covering today with our two groups of panelists. And we're doing that in the context of what we consider to be quite a changed landscape in terms of the availability of capital in New Zealand. We've had some recent announcements with the Finistere Aotearoa Fund, which is a dedicated fund for agri-food tech. And when we Agritech New Zealand and government started out with the industry transformation plan, it was one of the aspirations to make sure that there were more funds like that in place. And so that's been quite a milestone for the industry transformation work. And of course, it happens in the context of existing funds and hopefully growing funds as well. So today's conversation will be, if there's funding available, well, what does investability look like, and what are some of the things to consider in that space? So that's the background. Like I say, we're online today, and it is great to be supported by all our Australian counterparts. So welcome, guys, and hello, Mum, as well, by the way, since we're online as well. Better get that in or I'll be in trouble. I do want to particularly acknowledge ASX and Blair, who'll be speaking with us today, for their support in bringing these sessions together. And also for MB and the rest of the all of government industry transformation plan team. There's been a lot of joint work going into both, you know, some of the background to the landscape that's happening here at the moment, and also them helping us share these stories. So they're helping making sure we get it recorded and the like. I want to acknowledge our chair, Kenneth Irons, who I believe is online. He'll be waving furiously at his own screen. We have two new council members here as well. So MJ Alvarez and Kylie Horomia, who's in the room, are new executive council members on our independent seat, sharing our independent seat. And of course, I'd like to recognize Peter and Jackie, sort of the founding directors of Agritech NZ, who are still great supporters for all of our work. To kick off, I would like to introduce Professor Frank Scrimgeour, who's our host here with the University of Waikato, distinguished economics professor, business and policy advisor, and head of the School of Accounting, Finance, and Economics. So no better man to welcome us here today and give some context. Frank.
Tena koto katoa. Welcome. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here on behalf of our Vice-Chancellor, Neil Quigley. This campus is built on the aspiration of building greater links between the academy and the world of commerce and the community. And so it's a privilege for us to host everyone here this afternoon. It was a pleasure to be involved in some initial thoughts about the hosting of this event, because it brings together two of areas where I've worked on throughout my career. starting off in the areas of agriculture and then proceeding to a career more focused on economics and finance. But having listened to our opening, it also sort of links in a third part of my academic journey, and so I'll acknowledge my BD. And so when it comes to a wedding and bringing two parties together, you know, one of the important pastoral issues is the matter of communication. And I suggest to you one of the really important elements of this event is improving the quality of conversation between participants engaged in this intersection between two vital sectors of our economy. So let's learn how to engage better. I know many of us have been on this journey for some time, but I suggest there is much further work to do in that space. And I suggest to you that the next challenge is to bring a new generation of people with us on that journey. I note that at the University of Waikato, we have a large number of finance graduates. It's the second largest number of graduates in our business school after the accountants. But where do they end up? You know, within 3 years, the vast majority of them are in Sydney or further afield. And so my challenge to myself, my challenge to you, is to find reasons to engage more of them early on in their internships and work experience and early career, but also to provide a reason for many of them to come back to Aotearoa New Zealand after they've gained useful experience elsewhere. So I won't keep rabbiting on my hobby horses, but I would like to emphasise again this challenge of enhancing the quality of our communications with each other. I find it's a challenge with my academics, I find it a challenge with our students, but then, dare I say, I'm currently working as an advisor on a business transaction, and I find there's plenty of mature adults who still need to work on their communication as well. So let's all embrace the challenge, have a successful afternoon. It is the honour of the University of Waikato to be your host today. Cheers.
Thank you, Frank, and I do think we're going to have a bit of a theme coming through in terms of maybe not marriage, but definitely communication and the interrelationship of effectively people doing business with people. So I'm sure those are themes. I did forget earlier on that we're from a housekeeping perspective. The exit from this building is through those doors and assembly in the courtyard just outside. The Whare Paku are split today, which sort of makes it interesting. So the Wahine can go to the bathroom behind us here, effectively behind these walls, which you can get through either way that way, and the Tane can do it over that side and go around that way. Not a very interesting story, but there was a story behind why that split. You can make up your own minds of what that is. And if you're watching online, I hope you can solve those problems for yourself without further guidance from here, because I can't go through the list. In all of these sessions, and Alicia and Kylie have already said this to me, and it's wise words, because as I say frequently, you never give a mick a mic. You could spend the next 2 hours just listening to me, and I would have no problem filling the space, but that's not the intent of today. We've got some people who've given up their time to come and share some of their insights today. So I'll give very brief introductions here, but then I'll allow each of our panelists in this session to introduce themselves briefly when I sit down. But just to give you an overview in terms of this investor panel, we have Blair Harrison joining us from ASX, and he'll talk through his background. We have Brent Ogilvie from Pacific Channel, Dean Tilyard from Finistere Ventures, Eleshea de Souza from LIC, and Maria Jose from Alvarez from New Zealand Growth Capital Partners. So the discussion today, let me grab a seat here so it's a little bit more collegial and I can move
was the priestly angle from the pulpit. I think in this discussion today, we'll probably cover a couple of angles, which is both sort of the overall sort of progress and environment in terms of what the investment scene looks like around agritech in New Zealand and worldwide specifically, but then maybe some specific thoughts or advice from you guys as the investors on, you know, what those seeking capital should really consider. So Dean, you're in the hot seat. Good to have you here. Thanks for coming along. Maybe you could just tell us a little bit about Finistere Ventures, and then we'll go from there.
Sure. I'm Dean Tilyard. I'm the New Zealand partner for Finistere Ventures. I've been working in startups for about the last 15 to 20 years. Based out of Palmerston North, we set up angel funds and did early stage commercialisation there. I'm a director of Sprout Agritech, which is a seed investor. I met Finistere Ventures in about 2014 with a company that we co-founded in Palmerston North, Biolumic, and Finistere led the Series A into that in 2017 and got to know that. Know the guys there. They'd previously made about 5 investments in New Zealand, so they were active in New Zealand. They're San Diego headquartered. One of the founding partners is a New Zealander, Arama Kukatai. So really talked with those guys about the state of agritech in New Zealand and how we could work together for our ambition, which was to create a really clear pathway from seed investment through to Series A and B and larger checks. So my involvement with them just increased. We now have dedicated funds in New Zealand. We announced the Finistere Aotearoa Fund with capital partners a couple months ago. That's around New Zealand 40 million available. We're doing our seed investment through Sprout Agritech. They're able to write $1 million checks, and we're really looking to target sort of later stage companies, you know, $5 million checks plus or minus. So we're quite excited about what happens in New Zealand. The challenge for an investor in a specialised space is the relative deal flow. And it's a challenge for all investors in New Zealand. So that's something that we've been really thoughtful about. It's something why we've dedicated an amount of time to seed investment. Just a quick comment, and you asked about context, and I think, you know, quite clearly this whole area has just grown, exploded in the last five years. There's quite a few people in this room who have been here for a while. If we were here 10 years ago, this room would be empty. So something transformative has happened in New Zealand, and that's down to a whole lot of people. But the other thing that's unique to agritech and food is that the global opportunity has exploded during this time. So every year Finistere does a review of global venture investing. We did one for the December year. Around $23 billion was invested in food and ag by venture capital investors. That's been growing at 50% compound annual growth year on year since 2011. So what is happening in the world is entrepreneurs are seeing the opportunity, and we'll hear more about that today. But there's also a large amount of institutional money coming to an investment class, agritech and food, which is still relatively small compared to others, but has this growth. So we're really excited to be in agritech. We love being a specialist. We love being experts in our domain. And, you know, we're really pumped about what's going to happen in New Zealand over the next few years.
Thanks, Dean. You've definitely been a big part of a lot of that journey, so I've been involved in this space for a lot longer than that five-year period that we've seen things kick off here. And I know we've had conversations before. You're invested in this sector, not just from a financial point of view, but through the whole journey in your different space. So, yeah, thanks for that context. Hey, Eleshea, really good to have you here. I'm sure you'll let people know about the LIC Accelerator, but I also know you're an entrepreneur in your own right, so it'd be good to hear a little bit about both your role at LIC, the Accelerator, and your own background.
Sure, thank you, Brendan. So hi everyone, I'm Eleshea D'Souza. I'm the Corporate Development Manager at LIC. If you're not familiar with LIC, it's a dairy-owned farmer cooperative, so similar to a Fonterra, but it's more from this, everything on sort of the farm-related side of things. So that includes genetic, herd management, diagnostics. We've got an app that 91% of dairy farmers use. LIC works by looking for new innovative ways to help our dairy farms be more productive. In my role, it's largely innovation-based, so I'm looking both globally and in New Zealand for new innovations and technologies that we can bring to our dairy farmers. So part of that is, it goes across mergers and acquisitions, joint ventures, strategic partnerships, collaborations. Part of my role is managing the LIC Accelerator Fund, which is an early stage investment fund that I've set up. And we've invested in two companies so far, Masterplex and Trackback. And we're looking for strategic investments where LIC can help these companies grow and support the ecosystem in New Zealand, as well as finding strategic partnerships to help our own business grow and bring new products to the market as well. So that's LIC. A bit about my background. So I'm a lawyer and chartered accountant, but largely spent most of my career in mergers and acquisitions, strategy, marketing. I've worked in New York and Amsterdam. In Amsterdam, that was for Fonterra, which was a really, really great time. Came back to New Zealand 4 years ago and started my own business. So it's a bit left field. It's in the art entertainment industry, teaching people how to paint in social environments. And every year it's grown about 150%, apart from COVID, which obviously impacts events quite a bit. That's been really fun as well. And taught me a lot of the entrepreneurial side of things, I guess.
You should have brought some art materials along for these guys. We'll do investment through the art of painting, yeah.
Yeah. Interpretive painting investment, yeah.
Thanks, Eleshea. Good to have you here. Hey, MJ, thank you for coming along. And I know, again, you've got a varied background from your, obviously, time in Chile, some startup time, and now your work with New Zealand Growth Capital Partners. So, yeah, please tell us a little bit about all of those stages.
Cool. Hi, everyone. I'm Maria Jose Alvarez, also known as MJ. I've been involved in the startup and innovation space for the last decade. I'm a biotechnology engineer by training, and during my time in academia, I developed some research that led to finding my own company, which operated for around 5 years. That was back home in Chile, as Brendan mentioned. And through my career and professional life, I've always kind of shied away from agritech and what it involved. Somehow it always finds me. So I've kind of embraced that now. And a lot of what I do and have done since is just intertwined related for sustainability, environment, and agriculture in general. The last decade, the second half of that decade, I've spent it in New Zealand working in commercialization and investment. A lot of my time has been working alongside some of the people in this panel, collaborating and investing with them, but also commercializing innovations from the university, CRIs, and kind of return on science and KiwiNet partnerships. So I spent some time looking what commercialization looks like from a research perspective. So communicating with people that do not have that business background and acumen and putting those teams together. And now at NCGCP, we're a government-funded venture capital, which operates from proof of concept to Series A. We are a generalist fund, and we also have an Elevate mechanism, which empowers fund to funds and have invested in both Pacific Channel in Finistere, New Zealand, so far alongside two others, which are Movac and Blackbird. And we really see that as the way of filling the gap for Series A and beyond, so we can retain and empower the talent of the tech innovation ecosystem in New Zealand for longer. So if you're a company raising up to 8, 12 million and a bit beyond, we have the ability and the talent and the capital to keep that in-house, which we see really as part of the evolution, touching on Dean's point, on how much the ecosystem has evolved in the last 20 years, and now there is a real need for that capital. One of our focus areas at NCGCP is agriculture, and we see that from a software perspective, but also from a deep tech perspective. So really, when we're thinking about new ways to feed the planet and being more sustainable and actually having a planet to continue living in, we really need to look into empowering and revitalizing some of the ancient practices that we've been doing, as well as creating new technologies, and I'm really excited to be a part of that.
Great, thanks, MJ. So great context in terms of the reason for investing in those spaces, as well as, like you say, being an active part of encouraging a greater selection of capital options in New Zealand, which is part of what we're recognizing today. Hey, Brent, thank you for coming along. Brent Ogilvie from Pacific Channel. I know that you've also got a long history of looking at some of the science and science areas that sort of MJ talks to, and have been behind some of the sector successes with things like Engender, and involved with the Pacific Channel Fund. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about yourself and the fund.
Sure, thanks for inviting us, Brennan. So Pacific Channel is a multi-stage venture capital fund. We're on to our second fund. It's a $55 million fund, including with support from New Zealand Growth Capital Partners, who are our largest investor into the fund. We focus on three areas, all deep technology. So for us, having a proprietary position is important. That's ag tech and food, health and clean tech. And actually, ultimately, in those themes, any of it can be involved in agriculture. As I said, focus on intellectual property strongly. Our first fund was smaller, and I spent actually most of my time, you know, trying to find later, larger investors. With the second fund, I feel like I spend most of my time trying to find better managers than we currently, you know, are ourselves or can find readily. So I've gone from being broker to recruiter, essentially, as the fund size has grown. we've got a great, other than me, young team. We're fortunate, I think, to have, over a number of years, had a couple of postgraduate internships working with our firm. And a lot of that talent, we've been able to either recruit, retain, gone into our portfolio companies, or have gone into important roles so they can work with us in other ways. So, that's us in a nutshell.
Great. Thank you, Brent. Thanks for coming along. Blair, thank you for being here. Thank you for enabling everything today. Love to hear a little bit about yourself and the ASX and the context for ASX wanting to be in a discussion like this as well, I guess.
Sure. Thanks, Brendan. So I moved back home to New Zealand a couple of years ago now, actually almost 2 years to the date. I'd been out of New Zealand for about 18 years. I'm originally from Christchurch but grew up in Lower Hutt. Became a lawyer in Wellington and then moved to London and worked in international capital markets there for a firm called Allan Overy, and then worked for Deutsche Bank and JP Morgan in London, with JP Morgan, I moved to Tokyo and then Sydney. And after a stint in Sydney with JP Morgan, I then moved to the ASX and worked in their derivatives team until the opportunity came up to take up a position here in New Zealand to open the New Zealand office, which we did in June 2019, as I mentioned, and that was an opportunity for me to move home with my family, which was great. Why is the ASX here? Well, a whole bunch of different reasons, really, but the main reason is that we now we have a lot of clients in New Zealand. We've got 64 New Zealand companies on the ASX. We've become, depending on the way you look at it, we've become the larger platform, the largest platform for New Zealand capital. New Zealand companies to raise capital in the public markets, and not taking anything away from the other exchange that's here in New Zealand, of course. But we have a significant pipeline as well. And what's interesting about that pipeline while we're here is really the growth of the ecosystem that surrounds the ASX, which has, over the last 5 years, kind of transformed really into an ecosystem that's focused on growth and growth companies, and therefore really focused on a really burgeoning sort of micro small cap market. So that's why we've seen this growth in technology. We've got over 250 technology companies on the ASX, and the total market cap of over 140 billion. Then you look at agriculture, and there's over 100 companies that are either agri or related to agriculture in some way, including food and tobacco, and again, sort of 50 billion or so combined market cap, if not higher. Where we are also focusing on now is we're starting to pull out certain sectors that we can see are really fitting that growth profile and matching some of the private investment, and then providing a pathway and maybe even just educating that as a pathway that you can actually become a public company at a certain stage in your pathway, and that can be a real pathway for you to raise capital that perhaps you may not have considered.
And can you sort of size, micro, small cap, what does that mean? And when we're thinking of the context of agri-tech organisations, we've got some established businesses, some of them here, what does that look like in the scheme of things?
So, I mean, the first thing to say about that is you don't have to be a very large company to list on the ASX. because the rules and the framework are such that it supports small companies, and it has done for a long time. That's primarily because it supported the resources industry and mining and companies that have set themselves up, and they've got a little bit of, you know, they've got some backing, and they dig a hole in the ground, and investors might, you know, get a return, and they may not. But that's sort of flown through to really that's kind of that's fueled this this growth focus. But what we do say is you really should start looking at the ASX when you're getting close to kind of a $50 million market cap. So where you're kind of heading sort of $5 million in revenue. You do not have to be profitable. In fact, there are many companies on the ASX which are not profitable because that's understood that you need to reinvest into research and development. But when you, by the time you hit the ASX as a listed company, you should really be closer to $10 million in revenue, be a $100 million market cap company, raising about $20. But you can certainly start that journey before that, doing pre-IPO rounds and so forth. But roughly as a rule of thumb, that's where you should be looking. What we don't want to encourage is companies coming too early, but we can. But I do find myself, particularly in New Zealand, having conversations around that level of companies saying, yeah, we're actually a year away from being that $100 million company, and we hadn't actually thought of the public markets as an opportunity. We just assumed that we'd, you know, be subject to an acquisition or a merger takeover.
Well, we're here to encourage the companies that are close to that and to try and get more towards that stage in the future as well. And Dean, you kicked off some comments with, I guess, a term that's more sort of fits sort of the investor landscape than necessarily businesses that are looking for investment individually themselves, but just this concept of deal flow and what it really looks like in New Zealand now and globally. I mean, I know we've got work going on with groups like Sprout Agritech, effectively encouraging and seeding and seeding ideas as much as anything else in terms of what's possible. How do you see the scene now and what's necessary to increase the deal flow? And I guess the definition, this is the Irishman talking too much again, but the definition of all of these success with all these funds is they'll get quickly consumed and we'll be shouting out for more, which is the what we all hope to see in the next while. Where do you see that happening?
Yeah, that's right, Brendan. You know, I think we're all vested in some way that we have some success across the market, and you know, some of the companies that we'll hear from today are already proving success there. I think when we look at the New Zealand landscape, you know, what a couple of things. What we see is companies that are, you know, surprising that they're in New Zealand, that they're doing interesting things. When we introduce them into our international network, people are surprised about that a company could do that out of New Zealand. Part of that's driven by our inventive nature. Part of it's driven by the cost structure that we can deal with here. We can do a lot more here with less. So when you go international, that can take some time to convince people that you've done that. So we see the number of companies starting, you know, increasing year on year in New Zealand. I think for us, the big thing, you know, to really put agritech onto the fast track in New Zealand is, you know, more commercialisation out of our R&D. And, you know, noted Frank's comments earlier on, you know, that does take a fair communication between all the parties. So we're certainly not interested in laying blame to different groups that might be involved in that ecosystem. By our math, it's about $500 to $700 million a year is spent in public sector R&D around food and ag, and you know the very basic question of where does that go, what is that being spent on, what were the outcomes from that? We're struggling to answer. So I think you know we all have our Crown Research Institute's doing great contract research. There is no spin out activity coming out of Crown Research Institute. So there's some structural things that need to change, and I think all of us, you know, we need to start asking the questions as to why. We need to start measuring it. If you start measuring things, things might start happening. And, you know, we need to figure out at a social and cultural level what we can do to lower the barriers. But for us, that is the big one. $500 to $700 million a year is a big number. I've been in many rooms in different parts of the world and talked about New Zealand. Agritech is one of the few industries in New Zealand that you can go globally and walk into a room and people will take you seriously about what you're about to say. After that, you say, well, we spend, you know, around $500 million US dollars a year, plus or minus, on agritech, that stops people in their tracks. They're immediately intrigued, oh, what's coming out. So for us, that's probably our strategic number one, to change the marketplace.
Yeah, and I guess we've already acknowledged that, you know, we've seen a change of the scene we're in now compared to where we were 5 years ago.
Sure.
So it's exactly the right time to be really questioning that. And I know, actually, no, I'm not going to say that because I'll again fall into me talking too much. Brent, I know that obviously you've been looking at deep tech. You've got successful investments that have come out of the university. So what are your thoughts in terms of the richness of potential deal flow and potential investments in the New Zealand scene?
I think the potential deal flow is very good. You know, much like Dean said, there's a great, you know, New Zealand's a biology-based economy. There's a lot of public R&D go into the system. You know, we've found anyway, you actually need to go and build a company around that. It's probably not going to come to us on a platter. And that's, you know, arguably challenging when you get to be a venture fund because the time and effort required to build a company is pretty significant. But for us at least, you know, our best successes to date have both been ag tech and you know, where we've helped build the company from the start. So I think there's an opportunity identifying groups of technological talent inside the universities, inside the research institutes, and really working with them, as Dean said, to address some of those social issues, you know, employment issues around how they can be comfortable in moving into a commercial environment. But if you get it right, you know, Brendan mentioned Engina technology, so that was one we took five problems in the dairy industry to the universities in New Zealand, and you know, it was a physics prof who put up a hand from the basement of the science building and said, I think I can address that problem, which was you know, separating female and male-bearing sperm cells for dairy, for artificial insemination, obviously. So, and it's not often you get physics profs thinking about those sorts of problems, but I think one of the beauties in New Zealand is you get not just, you know, the biologists, the ag scientists focused on these problems, but you can introduce those problems to a broader mix of scientists.
Frank opened up the session again, highlighting communication. You talk about getting, science-focused people getting comfortable with the commercial environment. It definitely sounds like a very human dynamic. I think we'll explore that quite a bit here with a few questions coming up. But before we do, I just, Eleshea, in terms of sort of deal flow, the investments that LIC Accelerator has made, what's it been like for you as you go and look for what's investable, what matches you can find, and what effort you need to put into finding those matches?
I guess for us it's relatively unique in that we're not just investing for monetary gain. There's particular thresholds we have to meet, but what we're really after is strategic partnerships and companies that we can help and nurture. So we're looking for companies that we can support with what trial. You made a really good point around getting there early and supporting those companies to grow, and the earlier you can get there, the easier it is to mould it so that it's solving a real problem in the industry rather than sort of continuing in the R&D spiral. So there's no like the fundamentals are all there in terms of the problems that need to be solved, and the companies we're working in New Zealand have been very surprised on how advanced they are. Because we don't just look in New Zealand, we look globally, and that means we need to compare the technologies that are being developed here across what others are working on internationally. And I've always been really surprised on how on point and often technically ahead the companies in New Zealand are. So although we're looking strategically, which means the deal flow in the pipeline isn't as large as if you're looking at the entire agri-tech industry, I think the quality has been very good in New Zealand.
Yeah, that's good to know. Hopefully, I'm sure we'll start seeing more. Again, as we talk about, you know, you talk about some of these things not being purely transactional. You've obviously got a strategic view, and then we talk about the important sort of effectively hooking up the right people and people doing business with people. You know, what? How do innovators choose the right type of investor? You know, if you had a friend, what advice would you give them in choosing the right type of investor? MJ, any thoughts?
Yep. Plenty. as a founder myself, it's a very, like, I can attest that it's a very scary and difficult journey. Raising capital is not a game, unlike the title of this chat. but it does take a lot of time and effort, and it's very energy and like emotional consumption. It takes you away from your business, like day to day, for several months, and it always goes longer than what you think it will go. So having supportive people, but also honest and transparent people with you from day one is really key. I think that NCGCP now is in a really clear and central position that we can be connectors as well from very early stage until later when we pass it on to some of our Elevate partners. So we try to engage, as everyone has mentioned, very early. I think there is a clear identification of talent. It's becoming an issue in the country, so we need to support that and provide the right tools so they stay and they're also not disincentivized, because it's a lot easier to just go get a 9-to-5 job than to raise a company. When you're in that journey, I think it's aligning what your vision and your mission in the company is and the right investors that can connect you to the right source of follow-on capital, because also capital raising is always about the next capital raise. So, okay, you have this 12 to 18 months, so what? How are you gonna provide value to your shareholders? How are you gonna provide and demonstrate that your company is worth what you're saying is worth? So having people that not only champions you, but also tells you the truth, because when you're meeting investors, a lot of the first-time coffees are very optimistic, and everyone loves your business, loves to stay in touch. Just let me know when you have a lead investor. I think that's a very kind of key line that some people are nodding. But it's also good to hear, actually, this is not right on point. You need to work on X, Y, and Z, and then come back and talk to me. And I feel that we, as a community, we don't do that enough. So it's clear, it's great to see now as the ecosystem has evolved and matured, getting some more specialization and people that really understand a sector and can provide that feedback with an actual knowledge background, rather than I think this is what you should be doing. So I think that would be my advice. Find your team leaders and work with them, but also take actual criticism the right way, because that's the only way that you can grow. And then the second one is you also have the ability to say no to capital. Founders, particularly first-time founders, get really excited when they see a term sheet, because it's like, oh, I don't have to talk to people, I don't have to have coffees, I get to go back and do my business again. But not every term sheet is equal, and not every term sheet is convenient for you. Again, we're thinking long-term. So these are businesses that will take 10 to 12 years to get built, and we have plenty of those in the room. Making one wrong decision now can impact your business in the short, but also in the long-term. And it can also deter you from the follow-on investment and the other investment partners that you can bring into the table. So I will say now, founders have the ability to say no. There's plenty of capital in the table. It's all about finding the right partners.
Yeah, much more complete dynamic than just a transaction. Yes. Yeah, thanks, MJ.
Probably with my entrepreneur hat on, I'd also say, as a business owner, you have a few options out there. You can fund things yourself. You can get a loan from the bank, or you can get investors, and they all have quite different risks and expectations as well. I think when you're after large amounts and you're comparing a loan from the bank versus getting investors in, when you get an investor in, you're giving up equity in your business, and you're giving up control, and knowing exactly what that looks like is really relevant as well. And I'd also say it's quite important to know exactly where you want to be in the long term. What you want the business to achieve, and making sure you're very aligned with your investors on that. Because if you're not ambitious enough, you're not likely to raise what you need to.
Yeah, spot on. Thanks, Eleshea. Brent. Sorry, Brent. Just for one sec. Yeah. Could we also get a roaming mic ready, and you guys have some questions ready as well in the next few minutes? But sorry, Brent. Go on, your thoughts.
No, I just think it's important, much like MJ was saying, for the entrepreneur to be building friends in the investment community. So often it seems to be they just want to get married, first meeting. And that might work for some, but doesn't necessarily work for us, right? So I think from the entrepreneur's perspective too, this is a 10-year relationship. That's probably longer than the average modern marriage. Catholic marriage is an exception, maybe. So you really want to get to know your investor well, because it's going to be a long, and it's not always going to go well. There's going to be times it's going to be hell. They should be doing due diligence on us as much as we're doing due diligence on them. And then the other thing I'd say is that, think carefully about what, investor-friendly terms actually mean. So it's nice, of course, to hang on to as much of the company as the founder as you can. That shouldn't be the only driver, right? So how is this investor going to help me? Money, obviously, but can they help me recruit people? Can they help me find a buyer? you know, the first buyer for the company's products, the eventual buyer of the company, or introduction to a Blair or Blair's, you know, ASX brokers. So how can you really help the company through its journey?
Yeah, excellent. I know, Dean, you've talked previously about the Finistere's view of what connected capital really means. Be good to hear a couple of comments on that. But also, just as you're doing that, also think about whether you've got any comments on sort of the common pitfalls that you've seen innovators make when it comes to investment.
Well, I think entrepreneurs in New Zealand are getting really good at it. So we do meet some people, and everyone here has met the same, who know how to go about it. I think what Brent said really resonates. I definitely have felt in the past that it's transactional. The founder turns up and expects the ATM machine, fill out the form, and the money will come, and severely underestimates the time the process takes for everything to come into alignment. And, you know, there was waving a flag, you know, investors are humans as well and have lives and other things going on. And I think sometimes the companies don't appreciate that they're in a stack of other deals going on, that the investor is doing exactly what Brent outlined, which is looking forward, talking to people in their network. And for us, you mentioned connected capital. It's probably the primary area that we will focus on when diligencing a company, which is who and how in our network can we get leverage and connection, because we're trying to look to accelerate the company, and particularly in agritech, where we're symptoms to cycles that we all know about. You're looking to try, where can we go faster? Who can I open a door for? Ultimately want to put a syndicate together. Finistere always invests with a syndicate so that there is a broader shareholder base so that we can have some foundation for the next round and that connectivity. So there are people that do it excellently in New Zealand, but you know, my number one point would be to build a relationship and, you know, to put in all the good things about that relationship at the start, which is mutual understanding. It's mutual DD. I love it when people ask for our references and go and talk to other companies that we've invested in and have a look around us. Yeah, that would be the key point.
I was only joking about the marriage thing at the beginning. I didn't actually think it to be fully in context. I wonder whether there's any questions in the room, and I do emphasise questions. No statements, please. But if you have a question for the panel, would love to hear from you.
In a previous life, I was a venture capitalist. And at that time, it was, you know, Tom Perkins' big thing was identify the risk and invest in it first. We can all see the, you know, the hockey stick business plan and what that's about, but remove the obstacles to achievement and that sort of thing. Anybody in the panel that wants to offer this, you know, what do you see as the big risks that you're looking for to remove them, so we can perhaps have a go at removing them before we pitch up?
Well, I can start. One of the main risks that I see a lot of the agri-tech businesses when we're thinking about deep tech in particular is that as the solution being developed as a research-led solution with no market uptake. So have they actually talked to the farmers, the user, the end client? And that's one of the main things that we will check for. Is this actually needed or is this a nice to have? How global is this in New Zealand? We have a lot of unique qualities into our New Zealand horticulture, pastures, and way that we're doing agriculture business here. Some of them are very global. Some of them are unique things that we can solve and have a sustainable business, but that not necessarily is a venture play. So understanding, is this something with a New Zealand lens, with a global perspective from day one, or is this just a small business that will have sustainable revenue and that's it? I think that as a venture capital, we always acknowledge that there are risks, but it's how the company is mitigating those. So not necessarily having all the answers now, but how you go around thinking those, and are those things that will make sense. And then when we're talking about larger scale projects, are the unit economics gonna stack up? So is this a business that will turn into not necessarily 2 or 3 years from now, might be 10. We have one company in our portfolio that's been around with us for a bit over 12 years, and it's just about to launch product into the market this year. But you understand that, and as long as the R&D is being done with purpose and with the intention of launching that into the market, we're happy to offset that risk from our cap table. That would be my advice.
Thanks, Andrea.
Yeah, Alicia? There's two initial hurdles I look for. One is the team, because quite often when you're investing in the earlier stage, it's all about the team and the drive and what vision they have and their capability to achieve that. The second would be how well aware they are of the competitors and others in this space, because quite often we're approached by multiple people, multiple companies aiming to do the same thing, and we've got a really talented team of patent advisors, R&D staff, so we're able to very quickly validate new opportunities that come our way in terms of looking at the patent landscape, who else is in this space. And I think just them having that awareness of who else is out there, because quite often they'll say, oh no, we're the only ones, when you know that's not the case.
Any other questions from the room?
Maybe I could add an answer to that earlier one, Brennan. So for us, the market risk isn't so big, because we generally, if we're going to lead the investment, it's into a market disruption, and you assume there's a substantial market there. The risk for us is people, as someone said, and also patent, the proprietary position. So I think generally New Zealand companies underestimate, the corporate acquirer's interest in the intellectual property position. It's not just enough to have a patent. It's got to be, robust, cover the key areas of your innovation, prevent other competitors from replicating that. And, I think, as an example, one of our divestment processes, there was a corporate acquirer. They had 20 people on the acquisition team. 12 of them were lawyers. 5 of them were patent lawyers. And, happily, this company had a suite of patents for people to chew through. But it's incredibly important, I think, because that's what they're buying at the end of the day. They're hopefully buying innovation, machine, future innovation, but for today's acquisition, the sausage is there an intellectual property position I can exploit?
Yeah, I'll just to add a public market perspective to that. That flows through to the public markets, right? So one of the biggest risks, that we perceive is, you've got this great piece of technology, or this great IP, or these great people. When you become a public company, how's that going to be protected? Are you all of a sudden going to lose your IP to somebody else? What does that competitive landscape look like? So that's why we say, and I think this is probably echoing what some of the others in the panel said, that the listing should be a start, not a finish. It shouldn't be an exit. It should be a way to leverage, global public capital, basically, which means that, the founders and those with the IP should have skin in the game. They shouldn't be exiting at the IPO. They should be staying on. But the company itself should be prepared to be a public company. And we say, practice being a public company for a good year or two before we become a public company. Just understand what it means to be making those continuous disclosures and what that actually means, and what that means in terms of your IP, and what that means once you have to disclose that.
And the relationship with your investors, effectively.
Well, exactly, because the markets will, I think just to round it off as well, where we see a lot of success coming out of New Zealand is those New Zealand companies who have that global mindset. So they're not, it's fine to be patriotic, but don't be parochial. Think global, and we can see companies like Aroa Biosurgery, they're not, 95% of their distribution offshore. They had a great IPO because they're already geared up in that way, and there are so many New Zealand companies like that that are not really known in New Zealand because they're global companies from day one. So the important thing there, I guess, the risk to prepare oneself against is just the fact that once you're a public company, there are going to be a lot of sort of pressures on you, which can it stops you being private. You have to actually disclose. But the other edge of the sword to that is you're able to raise capital extremely quickly. And Grant Straker was in the paper this morning. I don't know if you saw, but he said, you know, he actually described to me, he was a paratrooper, I think, and but he said, you know, preparing for an IPO was the hardest thing he'd ever done. But now that he's done it, you know, they raised $35 million, and they can do that within 2 days in the public markets, mm-hmm. right? So that's the upshot. That's the upshot. But you've got to be able to protect what you have. Sorry, it was probably too long.
No, that was good.
By the way, I'm divorced. two kids out of wedlock and wedlock, so sorry about that, I had to confess.
I'm glad we set the scene for such, for such honesty. And and I know in terms of speaking of global companies, we're going to have some examples of people thinking globally from here in our next panel. And I am conscious of the time, so we could continue this discussion and get into many other avenues quite easily with this panel, and luckily we'll be doing so because many of this panel will join us for a session at Field Days next week on Thursday 17th, 11:30 to 12:30. So if you're in Field Days next week, please come and find us beside the pavilion, and we'll look at digging into some more conversation. I'm looking forward to some feedback from these guys. But maybe as a sort of a final comment, you know, if each of you just want to think about from this discussion, you know, what's left on your mind, what's not said right now, what should we cover next week, and what do you think are some of the things that innovators should be thinking about from this type of discussion?
You know, there's never been a better time to start and build a company out of New Zealand. And, you know, the global conditions, you know, despite COVID and everything else, are actually really good. The world is interested. And there's capital available in the country like there's never been before. So pretty exciting. That's what I think.
Mm, yeah, I agree. I think the fundamentals are all there, and we're solving very interesting problems in agritech. You've got the world population that's going to 10 billion by 2050. There's going to be a 70% increase in demand in food, and it's well accepted that that increase needs to come from efficiencies in food production. Right here where we are in New Zealand, we're in the perfect place to develop these new technologies, and the ecosystem is growing. You've got really strong government support with NZT and Callaghan Innovation, and the investors are building as well, strategic as well as financial investors here to help. So I think it's a very exciting time for the industry.
Not much to add, rather than come talk to any of us. If you're interested, if there's anything that we can do, might not necessarily lead to an investment, but we're always here to help. The people in this panel, more than anything, want the ecosystem and the industry to be sustainable and to be successful. So everyone's open for a coffee or a chat, and you will be surprised on how many people and how quickly you can expand your network through that. New Zealand, it's a place where 2 degrees of separation, so use that to your favor. Not only domestically, but also internationally. Within this panel, you have connectivity to pretty much everywhere else in the country, in the world. And as funds specialize, find your niche and grow from there. We have a lot of success and failure stories that you can learn from. There's a lot of that we can get takeaways, what not to repeat, but also what to do more of.
Yeah, here, well said, Andrea.
Thank you. I think it's an incredibly exciting place to be because you've got the potential to create great impact. You know, nutrition in China is producing extra 300 million middle-class citizens every 5 years. That's another America in terms of food consumption. There's an incredible amount of demand coming down the pipeline, and we need to find better ways of doing it efficiently, environmentally friendly. I personally think New Zealand needs to address some of the luggage from 2 decades or more back around biotechnology. You know, there are some new biotechnology tools that could really enhance our agricultural systems.
Yep.
And, you know, if we develop those in an environmentally and culturally respectable way, you know, there's a big opportunity for New Zealand.
I would just say don't forget the public markets, you know, when you're thinking of raising capital. But I mean, you know, seriously, I mean, you know, there's been a lot written about whether there's a bubble and why there's so many IPOs now, and most commentators say that it's viewed really it's just demonstrative of optimism in a sort of post-pandemic world. A lot of money is still being pumped in, and the macroeconomic factors are not going away anyway any time soon, right? Governments have poured lots of money in to deal with the global pandemic. Interest rates are low. The bond markets are low, and all of that kind of pushes towards the markets, and asset valuations are high as a result, and that's not going to change anytime soon. Don't forget that there is actually the competition to the public markets is the private capital, and so just don't forget the public money.
Great. Well, I'd just like to thank all our panellists. Thanks for sharing your time and your insights. I'm looking forward to some further conversations next week, and I'm sure we'll find some other channels to sort of pick out some of the really key points that we've been covering here. And it's been recorded for prosperity as well, so I'm sure we'll find other ways of sharing it. We're going to do a bit of a panel changeover now, but while we're doing that, so thank you very much, guys.
Thank you.
Just while we're doing that, we've sort of mentioned the global context for investments and the fact that this is a global dynamic in terms of the look at investability and the look at what role agritech can have for innovation in food systems. Today we've sort of organised this in partnership with our sister group over in Australia, Oz Agritech. Headed up by Executive Director Tori Kirk and Andrew Coppins, who's the chair over there. And so they are also an open membership-based association, and they look at fostering, you know, a world-class ecosystem for Australia. And as we look, when you start thinking global, we know that when the rest of the world looks to us here, they look to the region. And so I think what we can do together with Australia will strengthen both of us, both from an innovation point of view, an exchange of ideas, and being a site for investment. So if we're a successful region, that's how the world will see us, and without doubt, we'll all be stronger for that. So I would like to introduce Matthew Pryor, who's online. I've known Matthew for a long time. He's the co-founder of Tenacious Ventures, which is Australia's first and only dedicated agri-food tech VC firm. He's also a partner at Agthentic, along with Sarah Nollett. He was previously a co-founder of Observant, which many New Zealand companies would know from the work that they were doing in Australia and here. And that was a business that was acquired by Jane back in Yane Irrigation. I don't know if it was Jane or Yane, you have to correct me on that one, Matthew, back in 2017. So as a serial entrepreneur, a true ag tech pioneer, Matthew has extensive experience in technology, ag, both in Australia, the US, and covering both, I guess, that innovator perspective as well as that investor perspective. So Matthew, thanks for being online with us. Look forward to hearing from you.
Yeah, hey, Brendan. Hopefully that's coming through okay.
Lovely.
You got me. Awesome. And thanks for the opportunity to be part of the panel today. Thanks very much to the university, to Agritech NZ and ASX for helping to make this possible and reaching hands across the Tasman. We're very passionate about the region, as Brendan pointed out. I also wanted to start by just acknowledging the fact that I'm coming to you from lockdown Melbourne right now, and specifically from Kew in Victoria. And I want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the country that I'm from at the moment, which is the Wurundjeri Woi Wurrung people, and acknowledge their connection to land and country. The thoughts ahead, and I want to be pretty casual today, Brendan, so feel free to jump in with kind of questions or comments or prompts. But this concept of moving from the founder side of the table to the investor side of the table has already come up a bit today, which has been interesting. And I thought there might be a few stories I could share there. I'm actually pretty new to the venture world and have spent the overwhelming majority of my time as a founder. I've sort of done that journey three times, and two of those resulting in an exit. And I thought, again, because we're here to talk about sort of investability and the founder journey, there might be some lessons, mistakes that I have made that are worth sharing. The first, and we kind of touched on this too, really is the fact that ag tech is different in a lot of ways. I came to ag tech having done a tour of duty in Silicon Valley and kind of exited during the dot-com era and all the amazing sights of Silicon Valley, and sort of landed back in Australia wondering, you know, what might come next. And certainly back in 2004, there really wasn't such a thing as ag tech. But what really grabbed me was what Australia and New Zealand as well, of course, was really good at was being a world-class producer of agricultural produce. And in addition to that, and has also been pointed out today, this idea that, you know, as a big investor in research that originally was intended to improve the, you know, productivity, efficiency of our own farmers, in actual fact, had this amazing and growing international opportunity. And that seemed, you know, having you know, come back from Silicon Valley, just seemed like an enormous opportunity. And I was compelled to kind of dive in. But ultimately, you know, from 2004 ultimately to 2017, when Jane actually acquired Observant, you know, was a very long period of time. And it's fantastic and satisfying now to sort of sit back and look at where we are with ag tech and these fabulous global opportunities that founders from, you know, Australia and New Zealand are looking at. But it really has taken a long time and a lot of work to get here. And, you know, we've touched on a couple of times today also, this the journey sort of, you often don't know exactly where you're going to end up or what else is going to sort of happen in the kind of macro picture. And so it becomes especially important to kind of know, you know, where you're heading, or more important, the kind of people who are in the boat with you are up for the same journey. It's been talked about a bit today too, in terms of, you know, what does it actually mean to take on investing? It is a long journey, you know, in my case, most recently 13 years, even for early stage investor, you know, perspectives, that is a truly long time. And so understanding why you're going, where you're going is super important. One exercise we often do, not as a venture investor, but when we're working with earlier teams in kind of incubator sort of settings, is to get the founders to write down on a piece of paper, you know, what number needs to be on a check for you to kind of walk away today, and then fold that piece of paper up, chuck it in a bowl, and then hand it around. And each of the team kind of picks one out and reads out the number. Almost every time you run that, you find that the range is incredibly broad. And so just from the point of view of having your founders all kind of sharing that common idea of what does success look like, how will you know when you get there, is super important. Because as soon as you start having conversations with investors, you're bringing another set of stakeholders into that journey. And, you know, it's super important. You know, we touched on also this idea of, you know, VC investors are looking for a particular kind of profile, you know, going public on the ASX or a stock market of that kind is very different to a strategic acquisition by a kind of large corporate agribusiness. And you know, as again was pointed out, that isn't the end of the journey either. You know, all of those outcomes are just one transformation to another. So knowing what you're up for and feeling confident that the people who are in the boat with you are up for the same thing, you know, couldn't be more important. Second kind of lesson for me, I think, was, you know, it's often the case that you kind of invest in things that seem like a good idea at the time, but end up not really being worth it. We touched a little bit on IP, we touched a little bit on kind of commercial arrangements and that sort of thing. You know, through the Silicon Valley journey, the company I was with, we ended up getting sued for $30 million over a one-page agreement. Now, the fact that the disagreement had no legal basis really didn't matter, in contrast to the fact that that company that had a lot of money and was, you know, decided that they wanted a particular outcome, was prepared to pursue a very expensive litigation for a long period of time that they ultimately failed at. But, you know, whether it was a one page or whether it was 300 pages didn't make any difference when compared with the sheer cash flow drag of being able to support that litigation to get through to the end of being successful. So, you know, second lesson, I guess, is just make sure that you're really focusing on the things that are important today. Often advice, you know, it's easy to get advice. It's a lot harder to get advice that comes with the context of where your business is today. So when you're focusing on things and you're taking that input from people, you know, really understand whether or not they share that right perspective. So at the end of a long journey, you often, it's a good idea to take some time out. And that's exactly what I did. Had some time off, spent 18 months in the post-acquisition organization, saw a lot of ag tech in the US and India and in Israel, and just couldn't shake the idea that our region was not batting at its potential. And so ultimately that's when I made the switch and decided that really getting into high conviction, high support venture in Australia was what was going to be next for me. So ultimately what that looks like is Tenacious Ventures. We are a sector specific VC firm. Our first fund just announced the first close, oversubscribed at 35 million Australian. Again, that sounds like it was an easy outcome. It was a lot of hard work. I think it was 200 meetings to get to the first $20 million first close. So, everything worth doing takes a lot of effort. But ultimately, our intention is to be a high conviction early stage. So, largely seed and Series A, sector-specific investor in agri-food innovation. Largely focused on Australia, but very comfortable investing in New Zealand and Australia and the US, and have in fact done so. Two of the six investments we've made to date are based in the US, as it turns out. And the other part of that is, a lot of what we bring to the table also is what's informed by the kind of related other parts of our business. So AgFinic Advisory and the AgTech So What kind of content platform all sort of form together to really help us be very focused on large and global, kind of impact delivering opportunity in agri-food innovation. So Brendan, just check me on time there if you wanted to drop for questions here.
No, you keep going and finish them.
Cool. That's great. Yeah, great. So a little bit, we're here again to talk about investability. So a little bit about, specifically what Tenacious is looking for. We even though we call it ag tech or agri tech, we're not focused on technology specifically. What we're really interested in is genuine business model innovation. And often we find that comes from a unique insight. Sometimes that even comes from people coming into agriculture from outside, but not always. A lot of it is also primary producer driven innovation. But ultimately, we find that's typically a matched pair. There's a kind of business model insight, a different way of doing something, backed up by a sort of defensible innovation. Now that defensible innovation, can come in a lot of different forms, certainly not exclusively software. Agriculture is a hard undertaking and involves, very, substantially interaction with the physical world. And so a lot of that ultimately will take the form of hardware, mechanical, electromechanical, and all that kind of stuff. And we're all very comfortable in that domain. But ultimately, as an early stage investor, those insights and that belief in the plan that will deliver on that innovation comes from a team. That team won't always be complete, but has to be, significantly match fit for the journey that's being undertaken. Yeah, and so maybe I'll finish there, Brendan, and see if there are any particular questions, but wanted to leave time for that in any case.
Yeah, happy to field any questions that people would like us to throw across the Tasman. I think you've covered things really well, Matt, and you've emphasised some of the themes that you would have heard from the previous discussions as well, in terms of, I guess, the relationship rather than transactional nature of these type of engagements. You've been talking about being in the boat with people. We've been talking about marriage, but probably really meaning in the boat. And so I guess there's definitely some common themes, and I guess since we're talking about marriage, it's probably also worth acknowledging that your own story, from being an innovator through Observant and building that up for its point, and then moving on to the role here with Tenacious Ventures, is a pretty common one as well. When we look at our innovators who we're just about to speak with, many of them are also investors, have been investors, and even many of our investors that we've been talking to here. So not only do we have marriage going on, I think we have quite a bit of sort of cross relationships and maybe even some incest going on at different times as well. So it's becoming a very murky field. Hey, I'm conscious of time, so
yeah, sure.
And so, sorry, we have one question, Matt, just coming through. And just while this question is coming through, could I ask our innovator panel if they could sort of take their seats up front here? And MJ, yes. Your mic is off now. I'll repeat the question for Matthew here.
Between New Zealand and Australia is becoming more prevalent. Would you have any advice when to engage with Australian venture capital? And is it any different to raising capital within New Zealand? What do you think that the nexus between both countries will be, in particularly in agritech?
Yeah, great question. I think I got the full question there. So my answer is, as a sector-specific fund, you know, we're super comfortable being very early. And I actually think, MJ, you made the comment before, maybe, I might be getting that wrong, about wanting to be useful and helpful. And that should always be a precursor to an investment conversation. So I think the more we can get conversations like that going, and I'm sure the same is true of the StartMate program and Blackbird and plenty of the other Australian VC firms that are really, you know, wanting to very intentionally expand their universe to include New Zealand. So I would say don't hesitate. You know, sector specific might be a factor if it's agri-food, because there are things that are the same and different, both about Australia and New Zealand, but also as we look globally, as we've talked about before. But yeah, I think the advice would be, actually, it'll tell you a bunch about what sort of investors you're talking to as well. So reach out early and then expect it to be a high value bi-directional conversation.
Good point. Well said. Thanks, MJ. Thank you. Thank you, Matthew. Kia kaha over there as you're going through lockdown. Stay strong. You're doing it for all of us. We appreciate that. And we look forward to having you over here again soon and getting over to you as well and continuing some of these links with Oz Agritech and Tenacious Ventures. So thanks for coming online today.
Awesome. Us too. Thanks a lot.
Man. See you, Matt. We will like to move on to the next panel, and I think it's going to get even more interesting because I've got a couple of questions for these guys. It probably has to do with some of their.
Just as long as it's not about marriage.
No. I think what we're finding is it's about a much looser flow of relationships than just marriage. So we probably do.
I'll be reaching for the incense shortly.
Yeah. So I would like to just briefly introduce, obviously we've got Bridgit here, Chief Sustainability Officer with CropX and previous CEO of Regen. We've got Darryn Keiller, who's the CEO and founder of WayBeyond. Greg Jarvis, CEO of Bluelab. Steve Saunders, CEO and founder of Robotics Plus, and Timothy Allan, CEO and founder of Opco. So businesses that will be well known and respected by many of us here, and I'm sure by many of the audience in Australia and around the world as well. And we have set the scene about relationships. So I mean, the question is pretty simple for each of these guys. We do want to know who you have slept with and what it has been like. When you think of the relationships that you formed in growing your businesses, particularly with investors, of course, you can take the euphemism as far as you want, but maybe just a little bit of an introduction, Bridgit, about yourself, the journey for Regen, CropX. And what that's been like in terms of these relationships we do talk about with investors.
Thank you, Brendan. I think it's a bit of a hospital pass being the first one to have to answer that. But so for me, I founded Regen in 2010. So that was, you know, quite at the early stage of agtech investing. So I think some of our journey was a little bit different than had we started now. But one of the key things with that is one of our, you know, in our first round was Brent and Pacific Channel, and they were an investor and a key relationship that we built and has been a part of, you know, an important part of our journey as we moved through different funding rounds, shareholder relationships, and then eventually the acquisition by CropX, which again, as part of the relationships, CropX is one of their main investors is Finistere So, you know, it is very much networked, and looking at how as you go through that, you look at those networks and the relationships you can build off that. Mm. But for me, I'm still involved in the business and really enjoying it, and, you know, I'm happy to share a little bit more of the interactions I had along that pathway.
The relationship dynamics was the word I was going to use, but we'll get there. Darryn, obviously you've had your own investment relationship with Autogrow, and then took that to the next level. Can you tell us a little bit? And I know from part of our discussions, of course, that even before some of the current funds and opportunities were available here, you made the call to go where the capital is and find those relationships in different places. Tell us a bit about your own journey.
Sure. So. The space we're in is controlled environment agriculture, so that's quite important to understand from the outset. So that's a very small sector here in New Zealand, and it's not very well understood. And as Greg will also expand on, you know, our markets are international because that's where the customer base is. So Autogrow was an existing company that was focused on automation and control technology for greenhouses in that space. And essentially, it was a springboard for what is now WayBeyond. So we split the two companies in January. But what constitutes WayBeyond, which is around data and artificial intelligence applications into controlled environment farming, was born in 2016. It's the reason why I invested and where we kind of started the journey. And now we've got the two businesses split out, each running on their own sort of track. So the kind of investment story is the WayBeyond story. All of it's been privately funded, so about $12 million of private funding has taken the company from about 3 years of deep R&D through to them putting the products into market last year, which was, you know, great fun going out at the time that the pandemic was hitting. But we've built ourselves to about 17 enterprise customers across the US and Europe. So we're actually really happy with the progress we've made despite that massive hurdle. And we're out currently raising a $20 million US Series B fund in the US and Europe at the moment. So that gives you some idea of where we're kind of sitting on the journey. The other thing I'll mention as a bit of a setup is that, sort of taking on what Dean and some of the other speakers said on the first panel, is that I think part of the challenge in New Zealand is that the success of the growth of incubation funds and of the early part of the market of the last 15 years, which has been very successful, has also created a conundrum, because what it's done is created a whole bunch, hundreds of startups, but no capital market to support it. So it's playing catch up now on what has actually been a real success story with early stage company development. And that's now created a vacuum between the two. So that's why we're in a tricky spot right now, and specifically with agritech, I feel that there's going to have to be more. I'm of the mind that there needs to be more direct government intervention in the same fashion as Singapore and Israel, in order to fuel what should be one of our largest tech sectors, given that we're an agricultural economy. So that's my position from the get-go on that.
I think the proof in the pudding with that, I concur 100%, is how quickly we can consume some of these funds that are now available, you know, and see further funds following them along.
Yeah, I would suggest consume quite quickly, and that's why we've got to then look at, well, what's going to come behind
that. That's right, we need to be ready for that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Darryn. Hi, Timothy, thank you for joining us here today. Who have you slept with, and what has it been like?
Careful, like you say. I think UBCO's capital pathway has been relatively progressive. So I think the first funding we had was $500,000, just over, in 2015, and that was to get us into production. And so we've always had a capital plan even before that, because, you know, when we set it out, I said, well, look, we have to have a capital plan. It's definitely going to require a lot of capital to get this done because of what it is. It's, you know, it's a complex hardware product. So then we got just into revenue, and that obviously enabled you to access the sort of wholesale, you know, angel investing market in New Zealand. And I guess we've always had a pretty diverse range of investors, so pretty agnostic. I mean, I'd been involved with enterprise angels here, So that's one channel, but I always got along really well with the guys at Snowball, and they've got a pretty progressive digital platform, and that's actually, you know, that's probably become our predominant wholesale channel. We've always had a wholesale component to every fundraise we've done. And then, I mean, you're presenting and talking to people continuously through the help process, but then, so like, so that would have been 2015 is your first, 2016 is sort of a more substantial, it's about 3 million. And then probably in 2019, we did a Series A, and that was about six. And so that was about, probably 50% of it was wholesale and 50% of it was venture capital. And so that was, we had GD1 Fund 2 invest at that point. And then if you sort of track it through today, we just finished a convertible that's probably close to 15 million. And that's linked to a Series B of probably 20 million. And that's, you've got two venture capital firms and a strategic investing in that. So I would say that the very strong connecting thread in all of that is relationships. So the strategic is the person that owns the number one bike made the direct introduction to the guys, and they'd worked together for 10 years who then, and then, and so, you know, that's like, you, like, there's a lot of serendipity in it, I think. There's a lot of relationships. I think our first venture investment was definitely driven, you know, I've got a strong relationship with our chair, Catherine Sanford, and she had been really active independently in the angel investment community. And so the venture capital firm liked the relationship that we had. They had a good relationship with her, and that has helped a lot. So I think, you know, definitely relationships are really important. And you don't know, you know, I mean, I think, you know, Chintaka saw me present at, say, the agritech showcase in 2016, but at that point, not interested. But you roll forward, and then, you know, that was post-US market entry, post kind of road legal, post a whole lot of other milestones the business has done, and suddenly, okay, well, this is starting to look a little bit more interesting and aligned with their fund kind of attributes. So, but it is progressive, and you've got to work really hard in between to kind of at each stage reset your milestones so you're clear, I think, on what, in essence, you know, progressing the business and logically success looks like at that next stage, because it does change. I mean, what's important? I think the big thing that I've noticed is that, I mean, I think the importance of the relationships does, it has a tempo, and so they will change. I mean, obviously investors that were important to us 3 years ago perhaps aren't today. And, you know, that you've got new relationships coming into Spectre, and, you know, how they work and the things that are important to them are different to, say, what was important to somebody in 2016.
Yeah, so investors suiting both the time of the business as well as the type of business. And I guess all the businesses we're sort of talked through today have some obviously have significant elements of uniqueness to them, and of course we should have mentioned, of course, from a utility electrical bike perspective, you know, both the volumes of your product and the places that your product gets to globally will be quite defining features of who the right investors are to appreciate that type of business. And it sounds like they've also been involved in effectively forming some of the shape of that business along the way as well.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, all the people that have had a significant role in investing have also helped, you know, because the people that you talk to, that you share information with, that you know, you're looking for feedback in a strategic sense. And there's definitely a thing where sometimes you don't know what you don't know, so someone will look at something differently and go, actually, you should really go and talk to this person over here, and that person turns out to be particularly important to shape the way that you see something. And so I definitely think it is not just money, because I think if you are just approaching it from the money perspective, it is probably like you say, I mean, it is, you have to build a rapport and a relationship before that actually happens, and if you try and force it. I mean, sometimes investment happens more quickly, and maybe more relationship building afterwards. I mean, there isn't any sort of specific thing, but the fit, strategic fit, has got to be there. Yeah.
And in terms of relationships, Steve, you know, the whole industry, you know, looks and admires and aspires to the type of relationship you've developed with Yamaha Ventures and other groups as well. I don't know whether that's the shining relationship in your own mind when you think of how the business is developing, but can you tell us a little bit about that journey and the people that have made a difference from an investment perspective for you?
Yeah, so we haven't been too liberal with relationships, so we've been really tight.
Very loyal.
Yeah. Very loyal, no. So, yeah, our journey's been a bit different. I mean, we were privileged from the outset that with Robotics Plus, I really formed that out of existing businesses. So our initial capital was self-funded, so really clear in our direction what we're doing. But use that time to spend offshore and building relationships and looking at who was in the space at the time, which is, we did our first piece of deal with Yamaha in 2017 and completed the full transaction in 2018. But we spent a bit of time in market to really understand what was happening in the market and finding who was in the space, who would add strategic value to us. That was actually the most important. I could self-fund myself or we could take money. So if I was going to take money, it needed to be more strategically focused as opposed to taking money for the sake of money. So Yamaha at the time had set up a venture fund in the US, and they were sort of looking at what does the future look like for Yamaha and what new industries may be interesting for them. And their team in the US really identified ag tech as an opportunity. And so I'd first met George, who was the COO of Yamaha Ventures at the time, and they were working through the strategy, so really just was on a Callahan trip actually and met George, and we just hit it off in terms of having fun and good relationship, and we just continued to communicate, and suddenly George said, oh, we've got this strategy, and I said, oh, that's pretty cool, you better, why don't you have a look at what we're doing, because it just rolls straight into your strategy. So showed him that, and next thing you know, we're actually doing a deal pretty quickly. The reason we did it in two parts was we were probably on track to do a record deal with a Japanese corporate, but then at the same time they decided to do a restructure. So a lot of the guys that had spent the time building a relationship at Yamaha corporate level in Japan were all changing positions. So their culture was, we think we should wait until the new person steps in and pick up that relationship. So again, the great thing with having that relationship, the venture arm in the US could just actually write a simple check. They wrote us a simple check on a safe note, which was really simple. I mean, basically, here was a few million, and if we raised some money at some point, we might have to they'd convert it or whatever. But there's virtually nothing, no rules to it. It was just like, here's this check. It was great. And then we sort of carried on, and as soon as the restructure done, we re-engaged back at corporate. So we then continued in the following year and completed the deal out. So it went through sort of two phases. The other part of that now was that, you know, we've always been very mindful, as Tim mentioned, about having a capital plan. So we've always been very mindful where our journey is and how we efficiently use the capital and being really well aware of our cash runways and what's happening and when do we have to start thinking about that next phase. But also knowing who our partner was, Yamaha, we know that they're not likely to be our acquisition partner. Their ethos has been about helping grow companies. So, you know, the other part was spending, knowing that we'll at some point do a significant Series B. I don't know if Yamaha was ever sort of seed or Series A, because it's the first money we ever took. Everyone calls it a Series A. I was going like, that was a seed deal, you know, 10 million US, that was our seed deal. So we're doing our A now. So we've spent a lot of time, it's the cup of coffee conversation. We've spent a lot of time in the US around the agritech scene, meeting with a lot of funds and different people, and we've built these relationships with a number of these over time. And come back to that communication, we're constantly been communicating with those people of our journey and how we're progressing. So they're always up to speed with actually what we're doing, and they're also seeing what we're doing. So that's really important, that whole communication piece, building that relationships. So some of these relationships I've been building for 4 years, even prior to taking the Yamaha money. So, and
before you need them, or you want to take the discussion to the next level. Yeah.
So we're doing a Series B round now. We're engaging with those relationships, and it's been really good through COVID having those relationships. But we did take on our first New Zealand investment, which is really in the form of a convertible note with ACC. So we're approached by ACC. They'd launched their impact fund, and we sort of thought, oh, this is pretty cool, we can be an impact company. it was good, but it was really quite meaningful for us, and actually the product that got the most recognition for that was what we're doing in the forestry. So it was really important for our partners that we partner with the forestry technology as well. So having ACC come on, recognise this impact, but the fact that the technology is removing people from dangerous jobs and positions on port side was really quite meaningful to the staff, meaningful to our partner, and actually also meaningful to Yamaha as well. So that's been a really good journey. So yeah, that's sort of the key. But on the capital piece,
that's a great match, and the meaning behind some of the relationships, and it's not just from a financial investment, but like you say, an impact investment, and having all those attributes that appeal to ACC, Yamaha, and yourselves.
Yeah.
Greg, I know your journey is unique as everybody else's is as well. You know, you from your time at PG Wrightson's looked at Bluelab and effectively acquired that business, focused that business, and have grown it.
You really went back a long way then.
Yeah. I know. Well, we know that you've had some very foundational relationships for a long time. So, yeah, maybe a little bit about your own journey. What role has access to capital played for Bluelab's growth to its current position?
Yeah, good question. Just for way of context, we are in the CA space, like Darryn described, and we've always been very globally focused, simply because, as Darryn has said, the size of the business here is very, very small, whereas very, very large overseas. So I think we've taken probably a fairly different approach, mainly because my wife and I, we sort of literally chucked our whole lives on the line. And so I think for the first 10 years, we had a fairly restrictive capital approach. In other words, if we, if it wasn't making money, we weren't sort of doing it. Our first, capital investors were a group of people that I got to know fairly well through our distribution relationship. So I had two investors from the UK and one from the US. And so at that stage, I sort of went down from like 100% through to 51. And then over the next probably 10 years, I progressively bought them back out. Until around 2017-2018, when it became clear that the remaining investor that was in at the time really had a very different view of the future to myself. So he was a guy who really wanted a new Lamborghini and a new yacht, and so really his focus was on a dividend stream. And you know, our focus was more on growth, so we found that there was almost like a natural parting of the ways at that point. And that's when the local firm here, Orion's Capital, came into the picture. So with that transaction, we were able to exit that shareholder and bring in a new investor set into the organisation. So I think what we've been able to do is to note the points of change within the business and move the capital structure to reflect those points of change. And I think it's really important that you sort of recognise when that change is starting to occur and when you need that additional investment. I think, like the other speakers, I think it's been very important to understand what you need the investment for, as opposed to just going out and raising a bunch of money. So I think it's really important that you understand what that investment is going to be for and how you're going to be using that capital and what you expect the future outcomes to look like as a result.
Thank you, Greg. And very similar themes, I guess, that Timothy was raising as well, as you know, those investor relationships change in form at different times as well. So some great stories there, guys. So, you know, simple question on top of that. When you think back along those journeys, are there any particular pitfalls that you'd sort of highlight for people looking at replicating your own journeys? Anything that stands to mind?
I think a point that when the investors were talking, you know, made me reflect on part of our journey is when you are in the process of looking for money, particularly early on when, you know, it's a lot harder, it's very tempting to take whatever you can get on whatever terms you can get because that seems like you've achieved the goal. And, you know, in our journey, you know, I look back and I think there were times when the terms could have been better, but I simply didn't know, or you feel like you haven't got the power to push back on them. And the other thing too is to say no to money. The relationship analogy is very true. And, you know, we had a situation of, you know, potentially getting an investor in who, it was a difficult discussion and negotiation that didn't feel very good. And then a little bit of wise counsel said, imagine what they'd be like as a shareholder. I think, well, yeah, that's actually a good thing to think about because it is for a long time. You know, it was over 10 years for Regen's journey. That's a long time to have someone who's a thorn in your side who doesn't share your values. And again, where, you know, you build a business, your values and your purpose for that business must be what leads it. And you need to get around you shareholders and investors who actually support those, otherwise you end up with tension that's not helpful. And again, when you're trying to grow a business, you need everyone on your side as much as possible.
What I was going to sort of go from was very important to determine like what your level of ambition is. So that's really going to dictate a lot around, you know, how much capital you're going to need to have. So, you know, there's a lot of companies that only, you know, they want to dominate in the New Zealand market or they want to dominate in the Australasian market. That will dictate, you know, what they'll require to achieve that. When your goal from the beginning is to be global, when you want to impact something and cause a transformational effect in the industry, you're going to need a lot of money. I mean, that's basically what it comes down to. And I actually took a lot of my cue from Peter Beck. So I saw Peter speak at the Ice Angels in 2014. He talked about the journey of Rocket Lab, you know, and we're going back now before the more recent success, where he told the story about where he started, you know, where everybody thought he was just mad. You know, who was this guy? He used to work for Fisher and Paykel as an engineer. Wanted to create suborbital, you know, rockets. So, and look at where he is now. You know what I mean. So he was a very inspiring kind of character to listen to, and he also talked a lot about the capital challenge as well. And of course, he went off to the US and raised most of his principal capital there, and that's kind of where he kept going. And if we go back to 2016, so we were both on the same panel presenting at that same event in Palmerston North. There were eight firms that were put up. The other one I remember was Sharma, who founded the plant-based protein company.
Sunfed Food.
Yeah. So she was one of the other people I remember from that event. And you look at where we are in 5 years, and it feels to me like 5 years feels like 10 years to me right now. I mean, I've aged proportionally beyond the actual passing of time. It's a very, you know, it's a very tough journey. I want to pick up on some of MJ's points. I mean, I'm constantly talking to investors all the time. I mean, it's like it just never stops. And it does have an impact on your ability relative to the running of the company and how you're trying to drive the direction of the business, especially while it's scaling. So I think that, you know, if you're a founder in this audience or online, you need to be very mindful how much time you're going to have to commit to doing it. And you do need to bring people around you who have an understanding of how that market works because it's a very, very different world. I mean, I had a background in the corporate world, so I understood corporate financing really well. The whole venture capital side of it is very different. And on that, I think that you know, I've gone out and pitched or spoken to about 80 venture capitalists across Europe, the US, and Asia, which has been, you know, really fascinating. I would say with agritech, one of the challenges is it's just not a well-understood category. So the fact is you've got about 15 ag tech specialists in the world. Like, if you want to get into the guys that are deep subject matter experts in the space, Finistere is one of them. There are others, Lewis and Clark. ADM Capital in London, and a few more. And then you have the food tech specialists, who are very different again. And the point I would say to someone who's looking to raise capital is you really do have to understand, you know, the VCs, what is their thesis? So I talk about this a lot. You know, they all operate to a thesis. They have an idea about where the market's going, what the trends are, what the direction is, who are they likely to invest in. You need to figure that stuff out really quickly, because you're probably going to be wasting your time talking to them. So that's one thing, if their thesis is not in line with your own. The other thing I would say is, you know, don't talk to senior associates and associates, right? These are the analysts in the VC firms, right? All they're looking for is their tire kicking, their deal flowing. You've got to try and get to the managing principals of the firms if you want to have a really serious conversation about what you're trying to do. Otherwise, you just burn more time, and time is literally money. I mean, we're all running, well, you know, most of us are running burn rates, right? We're not, you know, we're pre-profit, revenueing pre-profit companies. And so, you know, we're constantly looking at that runway, as Steve was talking about before, and planning ahead all the time. So, you know, you've got to, because of speed, you've got to get to the right people, and you've got to build the relationships at the level of the market. So I think that's another really important thing to do, is don't get stuck in the bottom of the process, try and get to the top as fast as you can. And normally how we've achieved that, and normally where I see Steve, which is not here in Tauranga, is pre-COVID was basically at these international events. And a lot of what people like he and I do is we network a lot, you know what I mean? So we're just out hustling the floor, basically, trying to meet people and pitch. Yeah. Thanks. I'll stop there.
Oh, awesome.
Right. Yeah.
And I guess, I mean, you started out by talking about, you know, having that ambition, knowing the scale at which you're looking to grow, and then planning your relationships and your investment strategies around that. Timothy, you talked about having a very clear view in terms of, you know, what your capital requirements were going to be going forward because of that ambition that you had for your own business.
Yeah, and I think it's quite important. I mean, it's probably looking at it in a positive context because, as we talked about, it's the capital also does bring some interesting perspectives. I mean, it's probably fair to say that most of the people that are investing at that level are there for a specific reason. So you are dealing with people that can be really perceptive and can definitely give you a different view on things. And so I think that's really positive. I mean, the capital plan, I think it is a case of, and you know, there's still quite a dynamic environment. Like in our context, if you have a look at electric vehicles, one of the things that you don't necessarily want to do it, but you can't ignore it, which is, you know, if you have a look at SPAC listings in the US at the moment, there's a very high prevalence of EVs. So the risk you've got is they could be 50% as effective as you, but if you've got 100% more capital, well, it's not actually going to matter. So, you know, there are some things you've got to be aware of the landscape and what's occurring there. And, you know, we've talked to a number of people, both at the investment banking level, to people that have listed companies, and these are, you know, through contacts and friends and things like that, to understand whether or not it's something that you should actively consider, because it's not the pathway that we potentially have originally thought, but it also doesn't mean that it's wrong. And so you do, and the thing is that the quantum of capital is scary, but also, you know, if we bought the same mentality that we have today to that, you could probably use it very effectively. And, you know, if you want to be number one in the category at a global level, then, you know, if you could get to that amount of capital more quickly, it's not a bad thing necessarily. You do have to weigh up the business's level of maturity and your own team's ability to kind of withstand, you know, one of the trips that Catherine and I went on. We were talking with SoftBank, and they'd just invested something like $300 million into a company that turned over less than 10, and by their own admission, they said it probably blew the company to bits because it was just too much. Yeah, so they weren't ready. So I think it is sort of, we've always been progressive in the capital, progressive in people, So it's continuously, and I think one of the things I think Blair had said around thinking and acting like a public company, and let's say that's one of our aspirations, is that you do, you need to start actually the discipline of reporting, of communication, and that's at all levels. And interesting, Grant Straker, who's Grant and Mary are shareholders of ours as well, and Catherine and I talked to them about their experience listing, and he talked a lot about communication. Mm. And it's about people understanding what you do. And, you know, there's a lot of people, I mean, I worked extensively for a company, Pacific Edge, and people definitely didn't understand them well, like, you know, the level of defendability and things like that, because they'd really, but that's a communication challenge, right? Because it's like,
it's a different way of operating.
Yeah, how do you communicate so that the market actually adequately understands your defendability or your position? Yep.
Thanks, Timothy. Good. Well said. I guess we started out, you know, and sort of we started out with the context of, you know, that the investment landscape has changed, that there is now more capital available for agri-tech and agri-food related businesses. Darryn raises the point that there's still a vacuum there, that actually to consume those the funds that are there now hopefully won't actually take too long. And so the question is, what's following in behind that? You know, you're looking at the scene currently, Steve. How do you think the overall investment scene for agri-tech businesses is looking?
Oh, look, I think the point's been well made. There's more capital than ever around. But I'd still say to entrepreneurs, don't underestimate how much work it is to attract that capital, even though there's plentiful capital. And I think you've got to be, again, communication's really key, particularly if you're in sort of like things like the hardware space, because that's quite a challenging area to be in from a capital raise. You know, it's because you've got to think of a lot of things from your whole, you know, supply chain, partnerships, distribution, servicing. There's a lot of complexity in those models, and so when you've got that type of company, there's a lot more scrutiny from an investor perspective into that area, because they tend to grow into quite capital intensive companies. I think it's something we have to think about in New Zealand, is that with the amount of capital and the amount of startups, and particularly there's a lot of seed capital, we're actually really diluting the talent pool. So talent's becoming a real challenge in New Zealand, because the more we're creating these ecosystems, the more people are spreading out. And from a small country like New Zealand, that gets quite challenging about where does the talent sit, and a whole lot of people in little pockets all over the place, not particularly connected. So I think as you grow a company, you've got to be very mindful of where your talent's going to come from and how you're planning for that talent, because it's becoming more and more competitive for talent. And if you think, you know, New Zealand was attractive compared to Silicon Valley because the price you pay for a people there was just ridiculous. You're starting to see some of that activity starting to happen here, particularly in some of the more specialist fields, maybe data science and some of the top software guys and different pieces. So I think it's something we've got to be really mindful as we're growing this New Zealand ecosystem. We've got to create more talent, but we've got to be mindful we're diluting talent across as we create more and more startups across New Zealand. So it's just something to be aware of, I think.
Excellent point, and really, really well made. You know, we've got, whether it's businesses looking at what's happening around them, looking at where talent comes from, whether it's from our educational institutions or whether it's trying to bring people into New Zealand, without doubt, we're seeing a lot of businesses sucking up a lot of talent very quickly, and we're going to need more. I'm very conscious of the time, and even with a topic like that, I know we could kick into a much longer conversation. But what I might do is thank our panel for coming along and sharing so openly your insights. Encourage people to stick around and join us for a drink. You can grab a drink at home yourselves, anybody who's online over in Australia, and raise your glass in our direction. So I would like to thank you guys for coming along and sharing your insights. I'm looking forward to future conversations, both on the topic we started out at, the topic that we're tipping into, and it's a key point well taken, Steve. I'd just like to ask the audience to thank our panel for today. Thank you.
Um, So we covered quite a lot of ground. Thank you for coming along, and again thank you for all our panelists. Look forward to taking some of the thoughts and points further, both in conversations that will continue at Field Days next week, but also some of that thinking in other forums. I guess I really did start the whole marriage comment as a joke at the beginning, but it's as we continue to sort of explore the importance of people doing business with people and relationships, I guess what we all aspire to for the sector is some productive capacity coming out of these marriages, to see some children, some growth, some more businesses, definitely to grow and extend in the same way that these businesses are, which brings other challenges, as Steve introduced there as well, for New Zealand in terms of what do our skills and workforce really look like in New Zealand. Those are topics that are of real interest to us as a membership sector group. Part of the work that we do in the industry transformation plan in partnership with government and looking at future work beyond that as well does address both these issues of access to capital, the ambition that these guys represent and the importance that they say to match that ambition with good capital plans, and then to look at all the other issues that come together in trying to grow an ecosystem like this, which definitely includes skills and workforce. So there is some work going on that, and so you'll see that coming through from some of the Agritech NZ newsletters. About 60% of the people who turned up in the room today are members. Thank you very much, guys. Really appreciate your support. The other sort of 33% or so, not quite sure what you're thinking, but if you'd like to improve your thinking, come along and have a chat with me, and we can look at addressing that. I would like to thank the University of Waikato for hosting us here today, for Oz Agritech and the team in Australia for supporting, and we look forward to continued collaborations with you as we develop the Trans-Tasman ecosystem. ASX, of course, for bringing us here today, and for MB and the all of government team at the working on the industry transformation plan, that national plan for agritech as a sector. Thank you all for being here. And finally, I would like to thank the tech team who've done such a good job at capturing all of this, and Kerry, Caro, Andrea, and all the team at Agritech NZ who've helped pull this together. So thanks for your time today, guys. Stick around for a drink if you're in the room, and let's continue some of the conversations, and we'll see you again shortly. Thank you.